Prepare for a rude awakening.
Daniel had made provision for the Messiah, and now, 500 years later, the executors of his will brought their treasure-laden caravan into the city gates of Jerusalem with the proclamation, "We have come to worship he who is born King of the Jews." Herod sent them to the neighboring village of Beit Lechem, where the prophet Micah said the Mashiach would be born. The very night that Joseph was commanded in a vision to take the child and his mother and flee into Egypt, the night that Herod's orders to execute all male babies was issued, Daniel's treasure was delivered right to their door. Think about it. Joseph was so impoverished that he could only afford the poor man's sacrifice of two pigeons at the child's dedication, 40 days after his birth. Certainly, Joseph was not yet in possession of any gold, frankincense, or myrrh. But approximately a year and a half later, on the very night they had to escape into Egypt, the provision for their flight and sustenance arrived by special courier. That provision had been made 500 years earlier and prepared for the moment it was needed. The Almighty is the master of drama. When there appears to be no hope, his salvation is revealed. Truth is always more exciting than fictitious traditions and fairy tales based on ignorance of the scriptures. Leave your Western Gentile mentality behind as we explore the Bible from a Jewish or Hebrew perspective. This is the paradigm shift for which you have been waiting an entire lifetime.
Who are you?
We are three wise men.
What?
We are three wise men.
Well, what are you doing creeping out of a cowshed at 2 o'clock in the morning? That doesn't sound very wise to me.
We are astrologers. We have come from the east.
Is this some kind of joke?
We wish to praise the infant.
We must pay homage to him.
You're all drunk. Out, bursting in here with tales about oriental fortune tellers. Come on out.
No, no, we must see him.
Go and praise someone else's God.
We were led by a star.
Led by a bottle of all light. Go on out.
Well, we must see him. We have brought presents.
Out.
Gold, frankincense, myrrh.
Well, why didn't you say he's over there? Sorry, the place is a bit of a mess.
By what name are you calling him?
O'Brien.
We worship you, O'Brien, who are Lord over us all. Praise unto you, Brian, and to the Lord our Father. Amen.
You do a lot of this, then?
What?
This praising.
No.
If you're dropping by again, do pop in. And thanks a lot for the gold and frankincense. But don't worry too much about the myrrh next time, all right? Thank you. Goodbye. Well, weren't they nice?
Out of their mind.
Look at that. Here, that's mine. Hey, you forgot it.
In the book of Ezekiel, he wrote, "The angel brought me to the gate of the house of the Lord, and I beheld women weeping for Tammuz. Then said he unto me, Thou shalt see greater abominations. And he brought me into the inner court, where about 25 men had their back toward the temple, and they faced the east and worshiped the sun." Sun worship and the worship of Tammuz started in ancient Babylon. Nimrod built a city that was the center of his world government in which he was proclaimed God. His kingdom bore totalitarian rule over the people, reducing men to slaves in his political, economic, and religious system. According to ancient Jewish writings, Nimrod was slain by Noah's son Shem, and his body parts were scattered throughout the land of Shinar. Nimrod's devoted followers erected a tower that reached into the heavens, a huge obelisk like we see here in Caesarea, and in Washington, D.C., Heliopolis, Egypt, Rome, London, Paris, and New York City. This phallic symbol is the image of the uncircumcised penis of Nimrod, the father of Babylonian sun god worship. The Creator calls this the image of jealousy and an abomination. This Roman-created abomination, found recently in its proper state, toppled over and in pieces, was rebuilt in the summer of 2001. In the month of its completion, a gay pride parade was held in Tel Aviv, a befitting inauguration for this obelisk re-erection, and in the month of Tammuz, no less. Nimrod's widow Beltus, also known as Semiramis, not willing to let the kingdom slip through her fingers when her husband was killed, proclaimed that Nimrod had ascended into the heavens, was now the sun god, and that he had impregnated her with the rays of the sun. At least that was her story. Her child was born on the winter solstice on the ancient calendar, December 25th. Forevermore, this day would be celebrated as the day that Nimrod, the sun god, was reborn as Tammuz. The birth date of the Babylonian sun god is a shock to some in the West, but common knowledge among Jewish scholars and historians. Israel was taken captive into Babylon for their disobedience concerning sun god worship. We had also been captives in Egypt, where we took on the worship of Ra, the Egyptian sun god, who was born on December 25th. In 168 BC, the Syrian Greek general Antiochus Epiphanes occupied Jerusalem and set up a statue of Zeus in the temple on Zeus's birthday, and proclaimed that Zeus was God on December 25th. And when Rome conquered Jerusalem, they hung Jewish patriots on the cross of Mithra as a sacrifice to the Roman sun god who was born on, you guessed it, December 25th. The confusion of languages at the Tower of Babel scattered the heathen into the far corners of the earth and confused the names of their gods. But the worship rituals remain much the same throughout the earth. There is one date that I assure you, Yahshua of Nazareth was not born, December 25th. But who was? Little baby Tammuz.